If you attended about a month ago, Karen Sensor from the Technion gave a talk about combinatorial structures induced by distributed algorithms. And so in some sense, this talk complements her presentation. And in her case, she considered networking algorithms for different kinds of computations on graphs. In particular, she presented a class of equivalence results, which shows that, for example, to implement a synchronizer in a graph, like to take a distributed asynchronous algorithm and turn it into a synchronous one without failures, but on a graph with specific properties, it is equivalent to finding a spanner graph with specific properties for this given graph. So in some sense, the spanner graph captures the difficulty of solving the synchronizer problem. So I will try to present a class of results which have similar nature but completely different applications. So what I'm trying to do is I'm going to consider a distributed computing model, a model of a distributed computation, and show that the whole set of executions of this model can be seen as a geometric structure, like a simplicial complex. And by exploring the properties of this complex, we could somehow devise, understand what can be solved and what cannot be solved in this model of computation. It's going to be mostly very abstract. So to make it look a little bit practical, I gave this slide. And this motivates the whole idea of exploring this kind of models, or the models I'm going to talk about. So this is if you've heard about the Moore's law, about like in the early 70s, George Moore would propose that the number of transistors on an integrated circuit would double every 18 months. So that would result in exponentially increasing clock speed of an individual processor. So the computing power of our machines was growing exponentially until some moment. So at some point, this density of semiconductors on the circuit couldn't grow any longer for multiple physical limitations. So as a result, as you can see, the clock speed of processors flattened down from the 2003, 2004. The manufacturers gave up in increasing the computing power of an individual processor, and it would go for multiprocessor machines. So the mainstream computing now is a multiprocessor computing, is a concurrent computing. So what we have now is sort of concurrency revolution. So every mainstream machine we have is a multiprocessor machine. So which means that we need some concurrent code, and we would expect that the more cores, the more processors we put on the machine, the more computing power we would gain. But this is not as easy because the results of those individual computations by different processors should be somehow synchronized, and that there's this folklore theorem of Gene Amdahl that the synchronization cost, the cost of exchange of this information between the individually computing units, is crucial for the performance of our computation as a whole. Okay, so the synchronization cost is an important factor in modern computing. But the synchronization is difficult. And one of the difficulties in synchronizing is the diversity of models of computation. So basically, there's a folklore statement that almost every research group which works in distributed computing has its own model to work in. So as a result, we have all these kinds of different approaches. So some people prefer to work work with locks. Some prefer to work with non-blocking, lock-free algorithms using strong synchronization abstractions. You have higher-level synchronization abstractions such as transactional memory. We have different assumptions about who can fail and at what times. So you have different resilience models. You have different communication models. You can assume that the processes in the system communicate via message passing or shared memory. And you have different generalizations of fault models. So you can say, okay, it's instead of just assuming that failures are uniformly independently distributed, you can assume some correlated failures and so on. So that creates this notion of adversaries. So altogether, it looks like we try to touch the very same creature, which is a distributed computing system, but from different perspectives. So the spirit of this talk is to unify these perspectives and see what matters. So we need to understand which features matter in our modeling of a distributed system. And, okay, the immediate question is matter for what? And we are coming to the question of characterizing the power of a distributed computing model. And what is the characterization? And apparently there are two different meanings of this term. One is the conventional term of finding an equivalent, desirably simpler representation of a given object, okay, so that it would be more tractable, more easier to deal with. And another meaning is, it's coming from the movies or from the theater circles, is finding characters for a narrative. And in a nice way, both interpretations of this term fit very well for the story I'm going to tell. So in some sense, we're going to answer the question, which characters matter in this distributed computing business, okay? And we're going to show that certain characters, certain stories are in some sense equivalent. So we can focus this story, we can try to find this story to tell, which somehow tells everything about everything. Okay. So we are looking at the distributed computability play. So what is the play? So there are some characters, which are models and problems. And there is an intrigue. An intrigue for us is a given problem solvable in a given model. So what are the plays we can write using this intrigue? And Borges at some point said that, okay, there are in the whole world literature, there are only four stories to tell. So in some sense, what I'm trying to reduce to show that a large class of stories can be reduced to one. Okay. And which problems we consider? The problems are, in general, distributed computing is about implementing synchronization abstractions. Usual convenient abstractions are like queues or stacks or hash tables and so on. Or the large class of problems reduces to solving a task. So a task is a kind of a function which is computed on a number of distributed inputs, and it produces a number of distributed outputs, and it specifies the relations between the two. Okay. So for us, the main character is going to be a task. Okay. Models, also, there are huge variations of models, message passing, shared memory, and so on. So we are going to consider shared memory, read-write adversarial models. So we have processes which communicate using reading and writing in the shared memory, and there are some restrictions on which processes can fail in which executions. Okay, so this is usually classified as adversarial models. So for us, the intrigue is how to solve a task in read-write. Okay, so what is the task? So a task is specified by three parameters. One is the set of possible input vectors, the set of possible output vectors, and the task specification, which is a map between input vectors and output vectors. For each input vector, it gives the set of possible outputs. Okay. The classical example is consensus. Consensus is considered to be the most important task because in some sense it's universal. If you can solve consensus, you can solve any task. So what is consensus? Consensus assumes that inputs, so we have input vectors with values. So in this vector, each position corresponds to a value, to the input value of a specific process. Okay, so these values are coming from some set of values. To make things non-trivial, the set of values should be of size at least two. Okay, so if everybody proposes the same value, there's nothing to agree on. Okay, and the task requires that every output value should be an input value. So this is a restriction on this delta task specification. Okay, and it also it requires that no two outputs are different. So in all output vectors, all values are the same. Okay, so the task is non-trivial because depending on what process input, what inputs the processes have in a given execution, you have restrictions on the output. Okay, so this is just to illustrate. So assuming that before we like at the beginning of the computation, we have all possible inputs 0, 1, and 2 for three processes, and at the end they should agree on one of these two, one of these three actually. Each of the three is possible as output. Okay, so this is about tasks. So what about models? So we have n asynchronous processes. So asynchronous means that they have no notion of time. So there's no relative, there are no bounds on the relative process speeds. Okay, even though they communicate through reading and writing, which are considered to be atomic abstractions. So in one operation, read or write is atomic. But the processes themselves, they can take arbitrary time to think about when to perform the next step. Okay. And also, they are not only asynchronous, they are also prone to crashing. So each process can crash at any moment. Okay, well, later on we will consider different assumptions, but usually this assumption of T resilience says that at most T process can fail in an execution. Okay, so this is very common. So intuitively, it means that the failures occur with independent and identically distribution. Identical distributions. Okay. Well, in the case when any number of processes can fail up to n minus one, well, if everybody fails, there's nothing to compute. If up to n minus one processes can fail, this system is called wait-free. Basically, it means that when you perform your computation, any process should be able to complete to make progress without waiting for any others, because everybody else can be faulty. This is only about crash failure. So, otherwise, every process respects the algorithm it is given. Yeah, so it can only crash, stop taking steps. Okay, now to solve the task for us means to devise a distributed algorithm, meaning that assign an algorithm, a sequential algorithm, to each of the processes, so that when the processes start with inputs from a given input vector specified by the task, every correct process would eventually produce an output. Or correct, meaning never failing, never crashing process, so that the vector of all outputs matches the inputs with respect to the task specification. Okay. Okay. So now I'm going to tell a very easy story. Well, comparatively easy. So we explore the task solvability in the iterated snapshot memory. So what is the difference between the classical read-write memory and the iterative memory is that processes proceed in rounds. In each round, the process accesses the new memory. So in this memory, it writes its current state. Then it takes the snapshot of the whole memory and proceeds to the next one. So it never comes back to the previous memory. So you can view your memory as a sequence of layers. Okay. So if you don't see someone participating in the given memory, you will never see it. So you should proceed further, okay? And it's an abstraction. So of course no real system has this model of communication. But it's, as we will see, it's a quite convenient abstraction, and it's quite useful. Okay, so processes proceed in rounds. Each round, process writes to the memory, takes a snapshot. And what is nice about this model is that you can visualize it. You can visualize it very easily using this language of chromatic subdivisions. So you can take a simplicial complex representing the inputs of the task, and you can subdivide it. And what you get at the end is the sequence. Well, every element in the subdivision is going to be one finite run in this iterated model. Okay, so and this was observed by multiple people different times. Well, Barofsky and Gaffney gave a very informal justification for that, and then there were more formal proof of this by Kozlov, and then actually Afik and Gaffney also gave a simpler and very intuitive proof for this claim. Okay, so I will come to some figures showing how it looks like, but before that, let's observe the simplest impossibility result, which shows that consensus in this particular model cannot be solved weight-free. Okay, and when I say consensus cannot be solved weight-free, it's enough to show the impossibility for two processes. Because if two processes cannot solve consensus among them, of course, more processes cannot solve consensus among them in the weight-free manner. Okay, so I'm considering the specific case of two processes. And in this case, these two processes, P0 and P1, they propose just their identity. P0 proposes 0, P1 proposes 1. And if it turns out that P0 runs alone without even seeing P1, it must output 0. Okay? Because 0 is the only proposed value it sees. And as we remember, consensus requires that every decided value, every output value, should be a proposed one. Okay? So respectively, if P1 runs alone without seeing the participation of P0, it should decide 1. Okay? We're going to use it. Okay. So here's the most trivial example for the subdivision. So we have two processes, P0 and P1. So the initial state of this algorithm can be seen as an interval. So we have colors associated to the processes, like P0 is red and P1 is blue, is white, and the initial state is just the interval. So this is the one-dimensional simplex. Okay, it's just the interval. So after one round of this iterated immediate snapshot, we have a number of possible outcomes. So if you imagine, it's a read-write memory. So P0 writes to the memory and then takes the snapshot. In this case, it just reads the position of the memory written by P1. So it can read it before P1 writes or after P1 writes. So you have two possible outcomes, which corresponds to two possible vertices in this subdivision. Yeah, so P0 at the left corner of this interval, subdivided interval, reads before P1 writes. Okay. In the middle, it reads after P1 writes, which means that P0 sees the input of P1. Okay. And the same thing for P1. Okay, now the vertex corresponds to the state of a process. The simplex, which is the subinterval in the subdivision, corresponds to the state of the system. Okay, so the two vertices connected correspond to some execution, one round execution of our iterated model. Okay, so now you can see there are three possible executions. One in which both processes see each other. Okay, so these are the two guys in the middle. Okay, I guess I can use this. Yeah. So this is the interval in which they go proceed in lockstep. They write, and then they both read what they wrote. Okay. Then you have one execution in which P0 was fast. So it read before P1 writes. Okay. And then, of course, the other process P1 should see the value of P0. Okay, because it read after P1 writes. Okay. And the symmetric case, when P1 writes before, P1 reads before P0 writes, and of course, P0 in this case should see the value of P1. Okay, so we have three possible executions. And what is nice about this iterated model, that if you proceed in this way, so we run more and more rounds of this iterated model, we get more and more fine-grained subdivision of the given interval. Okay, so it gives us a more and more fine-grained subdivision. So in which each, like after one round, we have three possible intervals. Each of these intervals subdivided in exactly the same way. So in this particular case, the middle subinterval corresponds to the two rounds in which both processes proceed in lockstep. So they both see each other in both rounds. The corners correspond to the situation where P0 is always fast. In both rounds, it only sees itself. Similarly, P1 is fast in both rounds on the right side. Okay, and then all the remaining cases are enumerated through this subdivision. Okay? And now we can run it longer and longer and longer and longer. And the important point here is that the solo runs, the runs in which P0 or P1 only see themselves, remain connected no matter how long we run this this model. Okay? If they remain connected, and we know that by the requirement of consensus on the left, P0 must decide 0, and on the right, P1 must decide 1, yeah, because these processes only see their own inputs. Yeah, so they can only decide on their own inputs. So there must be some point between these two extreme executions in which you have contradictory decisions. Okay, so this is so if for some, well, at some point you need to take a decision and the process finally decides, so you can see that you must decide 0 here and 1 here, so it must be some point where two different decisions are taken. So you have an execution in this model in which two different decisions are taken, that somehow implies that the problem, the task of consensus, cannot be solved in this model. Okay. Well, I can generalize it. So I can consider three processes. Three processes correspond to the triangle. Okay, so the initial state of the system would be just a triangle. Okay, so now I need three colors. Okay. So then one round of this iterated immediate snapshot would correspond to something like this. So it would be a subdivision. If you can see that if you zoom on any one-dimensional face of this triangle, you would see exactly the same subdivision as we saw before. Yeah, the two processes, if they only see each other, like, for example, P0 and P2 only see each other because they happen to be fast. Okay, in this case, for example, P0 took a snapshot of the memory before, like, P1 or P2 had the chance to write. Okay, so in this case, P0 only sees itself. So this is adjacent to the state, to the vertex corresponding to P2, in which it sees both P0 and P2. But at the same time, it is also adjacent to the vertex in which P1 sees everybody. Because it was slow, so it took a snapshot after everybody wrote. Okay. So here you have all these triangles now correspond to the situation where, to specific executions of our model. Okay, so for example, the triangle in the middle corresponds to the situation where all three processes proceed in lockstep. Okay, so in the same way, I can continue for the second round of this iterated snapshot memory. I would get a more fine-grained subdivision and so on. So yeah. But you can see that, again, we have specific connectivity properties which are preserved. Okay, so no matter how long I run this this model. So an immediate conclusion of this, well, if you believe me that this this subdivision captures exactly the iterated immediate snapshot memory, well, which is I didn't prove, but I refer to the proofs in the literature. Then this result is immediate. So I can say that a task is solvable in this model, if and only if there is a chromatic preserving the colors of the process, simplicial map, continuous map, from the subdivision of certain degree, the standard chromatic subdivision of certain degree of the input complex of the task to the output complex of the task. Carry it by sigma here means that, okay, if I have a map, I should preserve that the inputs corresponding to the face of the, to the carrier of the simplex I map should actually respect the task specification. Okay, so because I cannot take an arbitrary map, I should respect the task. Okay? So this is just coming from the observation that this standard chromatic subdivision captures the iterated immediate snapshot model. Nothing more than that. Okay, so in some sense, the task computability in IIS, in the iterated model, is captured by some continuous maps between certain geometrical structures. Okay. Well, this is an iterated model. As I said, this, the model itself is not extremely realistic, so it doesn't exist in real machines. But in fact, we can show that the conventional read-write model and this iterated model are, in a strong sense, equivalent. So I can simulate an execution of the iterated model in the conventional one and vice versa. And the simulation is actually the so-called non-blocking. It means that if some process is active and correct in the original model, you can make sure that some of the correct process would appear correct in the simulated run, and vice versa. And actually, and apparently, this is sufficient for solving a task. Yeah, so it's for distributed tasks. It's sufficient. Okay. So which basically gives rise to what is known now as asynchronous computability theorem, coming from Herlich and Shavit, which claims that a task is wait-free solvable in read-write. Okay, wait-free. Remember that wait-free means that you solve a task without making any specific assumption about the number of failures, like everybody can fail. So it is solvable wait-free using read-write communication, if and only if there exists a simplicial, chromatic simplicial map from this standard chromatic subdivision of certain degree of the input complex to the output complex carried by the task. Okay, so we're solving the specific task. Okay. And well, so far we characterize exactly what does it mean to solve a task in read-write, wait-free. And the important corollary to this is the generalization of consensus, which is called K-set consensus. It's like consensus where you give the freedom to processes to agree not on a specific input value, but a set of values of size at most K. Okay, so this is a generalization of consensus, and we show that we can actually use this theorem to show that K-set consensus cannot be solved wait-free for K strictly less than the number of processes. Of course, if K is exactly the number of processes, there's nothing to agree on. So you can just output your own input, and it's going to be correct. So for K less than N, there's no wait-free solution for K-set consensus in read-write. This is basically, well, you can look at this structure of the subdivision. You can observe that the connectivity of the connectivity property of the subdivided simplex doesn't change. So you have the same level of connectivity, and basically if you want, we can visualize the output complex of consensus. I'm sorry, I just as two intervals, two disconnected intervals. So for consensus, for example, if I have binary inputs, the output complex for consensus is 0, 0, and 1, 1. So these are two possible simplices which I allow for consensus. And for set consensus, actually, for example, for three processes, for two-dimensional systems, set consensus can be visualized as a torus, but the torus has a hole inside. But we know that, for example, the subdivided simplex is connected, so we cannot map continuously a connected simplex to a connected complex with a hole. So that's basically the observation which is immediately coming from this asynchronous computability theorem. Well, so we sort of characterized, we showed that, okay, for wait-free read-write computability with respect to tasks, there is a very nice characterization coming from the existence of simplicial maps. But would be interesting to consider a more general case where you don't have possibly the wait-free assumptions, and many important tests can be shown not to be solved wait-free. So you need to do some assumptions, and one possible way to strengthen your model to assume is to assume some fault models. So you can assume that certain number of processes, maybe probably some subsets of processes are allowed to fail, but not everybody. So these assumptions are captured through the notion of adversaries. So an adversary is just a set system or on the set of processes, which says who can be correct in the model run. And this captures some like correlated faults and non-uniform faults, so it makes a lot of sense. So if I give you an example, for example, this can be seen as an adversary on the set of four processes P, Q, R, and S, so which would say that in any run either P is correct, or both Q and R are correct, or both R and S are correct. Okay, so this is our assumption, and you can see that for this particular case, we have a core. Well, we have two processes which are P and R, which cannot be both faulty in any execution. So in our model, at least one of these two processes should be correct, and this is called the core of the adversary. And it turns out that for a specific class of tasks, which are called colorless tasks, the core tells us all. So by the size of the core, we can immediately deduce whether the task is solvable or not. So this is the only important characteristic. And colorless here means that the task can be specified as a map between the set of inputs and set of outputs. We don't care who proposed which inputs and who produces which outputs. So for example, consensus is a colorless task. So for in consensus, if I see an output of some other process, I can safely adopt it. If I see an input of some other process, I can use it as my own input. I can give up my own input, which basically means that I can forget about process identities. I can forget about colors in the simplicial representation of our model. But well, for colorless tasks, as I said, we can reduce everything to the cores, and so there's this very nice result by Herlihy and Rajbaum showing that. To show that the task is solvable given an adversary with core size C is equivalent to showing that there exists a continuous map from the skeleton, from the geometrical realization of a skeleton of this input complex of certain dimension. Like skeleton is you just ignore all the simplexes of dimensions higher than in this case C. Yeah, and then if there is a map from this geometrical realization of the skeleton to the geometrical realization of the output complex, then the task is solvable. Otherwise, if no such map exists, the task is not solvable. And so it's generally the case that colorless tasks, since they don't care too much about the colors and the structure of this complex, you can reduce everything to just the geometrical realization of those complexes. So, for example, for the geometric realization of any degree of subdivision of this standard chromatic subdivision is the initial complex itself. So this is the subdivision preserves the realization. Okay, so as I said, colorless tasks is a very small subclass of possible tasks. It just reduces to the map between the inputs, the sets of inputs, sets of outputs. So it's not very interesting. So of course, the more interesting question is whether we could specify or characterize topologically solvability of generic tasks, which are not colorless. The tasks for which the identity of processes which propose the values are important. And if you and of course, like the generic task, weight-free solvability for all tasks is already characterized by this asynchronous computability theorem. So here we focus on the adversarial models. I think I overestimated my ability to fit this talk into this time slot. Maybe I should speed up a little bit. So. Again, this talk is not about any specific result. It's more like to give a flavor of this field and to give a list of references. So maybe if you get interested, we can talk more specifically. But what I was trying to say is, okay, we we focused on the subclass of models. So I started saying that an easy story to tell is show that a given task is solvable in the iterated model. And then I showed that, okay, the iterated models can be actually be shown equivalent in power to the non-iterated classical conventional models. Here I'm trying to do the same. I'm taking a sub-model. So now I take an iterated immediate snapshot model, but I take a subset of runs in this model. And I want to, later on, I show that, okay, first of all, I can characterize task solvability in this subset, and then I show that the subsets actually correspond to specific conventional adversarial models. So the subsets of models can be characterized anyhow, but what's important is that you can distinguish, in an infinite run, you can distinguish processes being fast or slow. So in this case, if you take infinitely many iterations of the model, the process is fast. If it's seen infinitely often by everyone, every other process, it is slow if it stops being seen by some other process from some point on. Okay, so this somehow corresponds to the situations where you have faulty or crashed process in the conventional model. But apparently this, if you just say, okay, I take a subset of this iterated runs and call this a model, okay, so this would be my sub-IIS model. But this is it's not this easy because these models are not necessarily compact. So meaning that, okay, if you can define a metric, and if in this metric you can find that a limit of a run does not necessarily belong to the model, even though if each of its element is in the model. So that that makes things harder, so that somehow enforces more complicated structures, which are not subdivisions, we call them terminating subdivisions. And these subdivisions, it's not a finite subdivision any longer, it's an infinite subdivision with certain vertices frozen. So I can stabilize on certain vertices. And for example, here, this is an example of a subdivision where I say that a specific interval, like in certain degree of the subdivision is frozen. I don't subdivide it any longer. I subdivide everything else, but not this specific interval. This specific interval corresponds to the case when the output for this specific process is already known, but not for the remaining ones. The remaining ones need to move forward and eventually produce an output. And okay, so that's bringing us to this theorem, which is generalizing the iterated variant of asynchronous computability theorem, which says that, okay, a task is solvable in a sub-IIS model and subset of iterated runs, if and only if there is a terminating subdivision now. Okay, so it's a terminating subdivision, yeah. And the simplicial map from the terminating subdivision to the output complex of the task, which is carried by the task specification. Okay, so, as I said, it's only for the iterated models, so we need to relate it to non-iterated one. It turns out that you can do it. I guess I will just simply skip this and give you reference to the paper. So in some sense, what I'm trying to say is that there is this story about task solvability, okay? So what I want at the end, of course, we are still far away from this, but what I want at the end is to find this story so that any other task solvability story in any other model can be reduced to it. By using simulations, I can reduce it to this story. And then to tell this story, it's enough for me to look at some combinatorial structures, such as simplicial complexes corresponding to the model. And yeah, so this is one candidate. I could say that, okay, it's a task is solvable. So I have this mark, which is, I relax the notion of solvability a little bit, so it doesn't, it's not extremely satisfactory, but it does give some, I think, does give some important insights about the essence of this problem. So it's solvable in an adversarial model, if and only if in the corresponding iterated sub-IIS model, I can find the terminating subdivision and can find the simplicial map, okay? Maybe one last remark about this. Okay, so it's good. We have this correspondence between task solvability and the existence of continuous maps in some abstract multidimensional geometric space. Is it decidable? Well, actually, the question, of course, is not. Okay, so you cannot just automatically prove that a given task is solved on a given model. And the example here is one simple example is a loop agreement task. It's one possible task which just basically says has an input, has a loop in the simplicial complex and three points, and it says that if you have two points, then you must agree on the loop interval between the points. If all three points are proposed by the processes, then you need to agree on some simplex in the complex. So it's actually you can show that this specific task is equivalent. Solving this task is equivalent to show that a given loop is contractible. And it is known that this question of loop contractibility is undecidable. So there's no easy way out. Okay, so coming to the conclusions. So what I hope I conveyed, it was very quick and maybe a little bit fumbled, but what I hope to convey in this talk that is that a large class of combinability questions can be reduced to the existence of continuous maps in geometric spaces corresponding to some models and problems. Of course, there are many questions which are open, and for example, I had this little mark showing that we could only prove it for a specific notion of task solvability, so we can generalize it. We can go beyond tasks. Of course, a task is just a one-shot abstraction. We might have long-lived objects, such as queues and hash tables, or maybe transactional memories. We could focus on more general failure models. This talk was about crash failures. You can also explore the power of models in which processes can deviate arbitrarily from their codes. Sometimes this is called Byzantine failures. And we can talk about time. We can introduce explicit time assumptions because, again, I was talking about asynchronous model. We can talk about partial synchrony. Complexity bounds, okay, this talk was about solvability. Like computability bounds of a model. We can talk about complexity bounds. Can we derive any interesting complexity bounds by looking at the combinatorial structures induced by these models? Well, what are these structures? We could focus on the structures themselves, and there is some class of works which explores the combinatorial structures induced by this kind of algorithms. So among the references, I think the first, maybe the most important, is the most important one, but by now the field got mature enough, so we have a textbook. So it's called Distributed Computing Through Combinatorial Topology. Some of the papers which appear in this list will show characterize the power of adversarial models, which probably is not addressed to the full extent in the book, so it's comparatively recent, so it is interesting to look at. There is a couple of papers about this decidability, a couple of papers about simulations between iterated and non-iterated models. I think it's a very interesting class of questions, and only some of them are resolved by now. And I thank you for your attention.